Okay, now we will measure the if again I want to emphasize that this is a 12 volts battery and this is the 12 volts input here of the inverter, and this is the 313 volts out AC square wave, and this is the bridge and this is the capacitor. So if this is 13 volts here, so we expect that this is already 313 volts here, so you don't need to measure capacitor here. The important thing is the current here, the amps. We'll check really how much it consumes. Now here we just set up, this is the capacitor. And this is our bulb to discharge the capacitor every time we charge and discharge. So I will concentrate my camera on this position. Okay, maybe this is better. Okay, this is good. Okay, now we have an initial amps here from the standby. It's something 1.5. There is a 1, 2, 3. How many slot here? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 is the level is at 10, so now almost is already on 1.5. I think this is the best. Okay, try to position your shorting plug. I'll tell you. Okay, short it. Oh, there's a movement that's going to something like 5. Okay, short it. Yeah, something for discharge. Okay, again. Discharge wind along. Okay. So, okay, moment. See, I will check how much the current. Very weak, actually, but it's on the something like 5. Okay, now we will, what we're gonna do is to measure. Now this is our test, so I think something like 4.5. that's 4.5 25 ampere. So since we are using the same meter, now we will set up this kind of connection. That it's not so much changes, only this is the thing we put in between the capacitor and this capacitor, filter capacitor is this one, and this capacitor this one. So we will remove this capacitor, so connect it. That's the output of the reactor, ambient collector reactor. Now we connect it here, so this is the input. Okay, inside need to be supplied by 12 volts, so we have these two wires going into the black box. This is what we call it, the black box. But still he's measuring the same consumption, so I will position again. So the same thing, we will charge and discharge. But with the meter here, we need now to measure the voltage here. Our meter maximum is 1000 volts. See, this one is 1000 volts. So here, the maximum 1000 was here. This is 1000 volts. This is, so we'll base it from this 10. This is the 1050, 1050, 250. So we will measure, we'll look on this area is already 10, become 1000. This is 8, become 800. First, we'll check the, now its position, we'll check the ammeter, and then we'll transfer there. Better to. Connected now. Oh, there is initial charge. Okay. 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 So we'll switch on, there's a switch here. We'll switch on and check how much. I don't know how I can. Again, I'm. Look, it's quite something like 6 now. Check the battery. Yeah. Oops. Again, repeat the beat. Yeah, I'm gonna again. Again. The meter is not properly assembled. Pag-ganun ko. Paglipat ko na. Okay, ha? Okay, again, really, it's not easy to measure because the meter, you just calibrate this meter. So, there's an initial charge. I will switch off the inverter. So, the initial charge measuring something like 1.5. Okay. Look carefully. Yes, okay. So here, now the meter full in the full power 1000 volts, you can check here. Here is setup. We'll remove. Look, it's going down, but as from the beginning, it starts from more than 1000 volts, but slowly decreasing. Okay, this is the capacitor. It's a little bit something like it's more if the first is the conventional reaching 4.5 to 5, I think this is 6 to 6.5. see, a little bit higher, and then and here. So So it's 1,000. It's 1,000 volts. But slowly, it's going down. This is our setup. Okay, again. Okay, discharge. So the meter is already down. It's already go to zero. And again. Now the meter, now it's 1,000, and this is slowly will go down. Because of the leakage resistance. But that's 1,000 volts. So one more time, discharge the capacitors. Okay. So the meter back to zero. So this is one last time. Check it. Something like here. It's 1,000, more than 1,000, something 1,100. And then it's going down. Okay, so that's what happened. So we'll write here 1,000 volts. And the current, something like 6 to 6.5. Based from the meter, since we are using the same ampere meter, look the difference. There is a little bit big difference from this one. It's not so much, but the big difference is here, 313 and 1,000 volts. You can see the big difference. It's times 3, huh? So it's something like 300% more than, more or less. But here the difference is just what, 6, something like 20%, 25. No, it's just less than 20%. But this is more than, from 300 volts to 1,000 volts. This is one reason, if you will remember, the testing of my car is standard motor, the 11 kilowatt motor. We use the testing on the USD conventional power supply. It's represent 36%, and using my technology with this ambient collector is 136%. So you will get the difference from 330 to 100 is almost the same. Although there is some slight, something like 20% increase on the ampere, but the output is tremendously higher. So it's connived with this output from our testing last February 24th with the DOST and DOE present on the time when I test my e-car. But you don't forget, the testing here is not a very powerful car. It's just we use a very slow moving car. On the time we are not yet ready to for a full power of the car, of the 11 kilowatt motor. Anyway, now the capacitor start to discharge. Now here, something like 200 volts now from here, go down slowly. So this is where we call it a black box. And if you remember, I have a black box there and it's covered. Some people telling that there is a battery inside. Yeah, they can tell everything, but now they don't need to guess, you know, they're only guessing on the time. But here I can show you what's inside. This is a very basic, actually this circuit, this is where I started. Look the parts. This is a MOSFET combined with IGBT. Some parts here, but there is no battery here. This is just a big coil. A big coil, and there is a transformer down. Maybe we can transformer. I can show you. There's nothing under. Transformer. Op amp. Here's some relay. That's all. Good enough to increase from 300, you know, 313 normally in a conventional way to 1000. So here we'll go how we extract this energy. Maybe I'll try to explain some, and I hope this will help. This is my original drawing, but it's a lot of writing, so we decide to write a new one to make it more clearer. We can go, the problem here first, since we have a 1000 or more than 300% efficiency comparison from the conventional one, so it means we can transfer it. We have 1000 volts here, 1000, so it's 500 500, so we can discharge it to the load, and the other capacitor will discharge it to the battery loop back, charge the battery. So it means the possibility of self-sustain is possible because we have enough power here. But there is a sequence here that you must remember. There is one here, the power flowing from 12 volts going here, and then 313, and then the reactor, and then charge the capacitor. That's one step. Second step is the discharging the capacitor to the load, and the other capacitor going to the battery. There's a sequence here, 1 2 3. But every time, so it means the one side, this is a one complete cycle like this. This is one cycle, 1 2 3, 1/3 of a second. Let's say the one cycle is 1 second, 1/3, 1/3 part of the 1 second assigned to charge the capacitor from here to here, and then the second part will be discharging to the load. The third part is this capacitor, lower capacitor, loop back to charge the battery. Yeah, so this is one complete cycle, but it's not as simple as that. What we are doing here is just a very slow collection of energy. But actually, in reality, if we are doing just 2 to 3 seconds process of 1 2 3, in reality we need at least 100,000 times per second. So that's a big, that's the biggest problem, and that's a little bit complication. And the more you go higher frequency, the more on this circuit will create harmonics. This is the harmonics. Although we are using a DC supply, but the harmonics will give you an AC signal of magnetic, you know, north, south, north, south magnetic field, or in the current is positive and negative. In a normal house, let's say in our country here, is a 60 hertz. The harmonics up to 7 to 10 frequency. Harmonics. It means if you have 60 hertz, it will create 120, it will 240, and so forth. Up to 7 times multiply. But my circuit creating not 7 to 10 harmonic frequency, it's creating up to 30 to 40 harmonic frequency. So there's a lot here scattered all over the circuit, and this setup is a quite big, it's quite space, you know, there's some space, but still very close proximity within each other. At high frequency, you cannot charge this one and this at the same time, because they will cancel itself, because there is the harmonics within the circuit. So you need to put some time division multiplex. You need a circuit, a time division multiplex, time division, this one, two, three, or else they will cancel each other. So now the problem, always this is the problem. A lot of engineer, inventor discovered a free energy, but the output always, it's no output. And actually this is the reason it takes me so long how to, you know, to avoid colliding each other, the harmonics frequency, because let's say one, this creating a lot of harmonics frequency on this side. So after you finish the step one, and now you go, now the time of step two, but the problem, the harmonics of this, it's still oscillating. So when you down, you discharge to the load, it's lesser energy. At the same time, this harmonics frequency will cancel the inverter frequency, because the inside there is also a frequency, and I will explain you later. So this one also will create an harmonics inside here and as well here. You know the difference why there's a big harmonics comparison to a normal powerhouse. This is 7 to 10, because we are using a capacitor discharge. This is more powerful. That create a lot of harmonics. So that's the big problem. So to solve this, there's a lot of way, and you need a very, very sophisticated equipment and a top-notch engineer that's well familiar with the RFI. And now this is the thing, you know, this is one cycle and this is the second cycle, but still 1 2 3 1 2 3. So now our circuit, if you will remember, I reached on this level, but it's low power only, because we are still designing circuit how to cancel all overlapping harmonic friction in every step. We are still doing that. And slowly, but take quite long, but surely we can solve all, but slowly, takes time and need a lot of money, because the engineer working with us, really they are very, very expensive engineers. They're not ordinary engineers. They're working at semiconductor, specializing in RFI. This is the thing I'm talking, this inverter. Here is the inverter. This is a simple circuit of inverter inside. This is the main circuit. Before, this is what happened inside. This is a primary. There is a first switch, and this is the second switch. There is a negative here, and this is a battery here. They're connected. So first, this will switch and will have some induction. And second, this one, this will switch off and this will on. So there is a alternating, that you can induction, alternate induction, you can produce a voltage here. It's up to you, high voltage. This is 12 volts, you can go up to 220 as long as you want, you know, it depends on the winding. But this is the simple basic circuit inside the inverter. It's just flip-flapping or alternating switch. Before, long time ago, maybe 30 years ago, 20 years, what they're using, the frequency is 50 to 60 hertz. But the efficiency, I mean, the changing of this is something 50, 60 hertz. But the efficiency is lesser, it's 80% efficiency. But now they produce a very good alternating switching here, a flip-flop circuit here, that can go up to 48 kilohertz. And the efficiency go to 95%. And some is 100 kilohertz, go to 97%, to 98. So here is the transformer of the this inside. This transformer can make 48 kilohertz, so it's changing fast. But before that, the 50 kilohertz is, so this is such a big, it's this times 10 times of this, it's a big to produce the same power of this. So before, if you can remember, the inverter is so big because of the transformer. Now here we have 48 kilohertz here, so my transformer there can handle just 1 second pulse and cannot go more higher. The best I can do on that transformer or is up to 90 hertz only. But we need not only 90, we need something a million hertz, many hundred thousand. So you need an air core. This is the air core. This is what we are using. You can see most of the video there is this coil. This is a coil, that air core. There's no iron inside. And this one can go even gigahertz, no problem. So to harness more energy, but it's still the same problem. Even I am doing just 1 hertz. 1 hertz, 1,000 hertz. And then I have this inverter, 48 kilohertz. It's still, I can overlap with the 48 because it's times 30 times harmonics. So I can overlap this frequency. So you need a very good time division reflex circuit. At the same time, you need a cancellation circuit. So the cancellation circuit is like this. Actually, this is a coil, this is a positive, this is a battery, this is the coil. The red one is one coil, and the blue one is another coil. It wind it together, so the supply here is positive, but the other one must be reversed. This will be negative, and this is the positive. Now we will cancel, let's say, the magnetic wave interference, because if you have a magnetic wave and then it's slammed into a coil, it will create current. So this one, let's say you have a polarity here of on the red side, north, and then this is the south. Once you powered up this the same time, this will become south and this will become north. So it will cancel the magnetic field of the coil. But if you want totally, it's zero. But if you want to, let's say 50%, you just put some tapping here. This is the cancellation adjustment on the blue side. So just put some tapping to reduce. This is a basic, simple. This is the perfect. No, this is not the perfect cancellation circuit. This is the basic. Just power here, 100% cancel out. But you want 50%, maybe here, or maybe 75%, or 25%. It's up to you to weigh by experiment, but this is the basic one. And regarding the circuit, how we get the energy, actually most of the engineers, they know by means of shorting. Even Tesla making it a short into the capacitor and then all the resistance coil here. But maybe I will make a good drawing here. Okay. If you have a coil here, a generator coil, now there is a magnet coming here. This is maybe the north and this is the south. Passing. You know? You're creating here and maybe another here in reverse order. So you will create an AC here. An AC signal going up here. But if you will short it on this peak, short it by instant, only this is not so long, just very sweet, and charge it to capacitor, it will give you times three the power going into it without difference, without much lag or resistance or more draw to the motor driving this magnet. So this is the you know, but at least you must put some bridge somewhere here, a bridge diode, you know, to, if you are using an AC, you need a bridge to make sure that this only go positive will go here and negative on this side. But this is the shorting, but the resistance that there is a low here. If your switching is high resistance, it means you need here is something like 0.005 ohms to achieve the shorting. And then if you're shorting, like now we are not using the mechanical shorting, we're using a MOSFET. It's just like this. Now this is the standard transistor before. So this is the drain, the source, or we call it collector, and this is the emitter, and always this is the gate or the base. This is where is the switching goes in, the shorting, this one. So you need here, the induction resistance must be 0.005 ohms. So if you have what I'm using here is IRF 840. The resistance is 0.28 ohms, I think. No, it's point, I don't know, I think it's 0.028 ohms. So if you make it parallel times 10, parallel to 10840, IRF 840, you will end up 0.0028 ohms. So you just need a parallel circuit of this so many to achieve the lowest resistance to make this shorting possible. Okay, that is the basic laws of shorting, but you will get a very increased, very high increase of output here, but the same power consumption on the driving force of this magnet. It's just the basic. I'm just telling you the basic. What more? I don't know what is more I can explain. SCR is not an ideal because it's a 5 ohms. There is a lot of, now like the IGBT, you know the IGBT. This is the best transistor, but expensive because the gate is really isolated. Actually, this is the diagram of that IGBT. The gate is really, this is what you need. So, any here, the conduction is really very low. So, but still you need that to parallel like MOSFET. But the problem on IGBT and even MOSFET, you need to put this filtering system to block any harmonics circulating inside the circuit, or else you will end up busted this IGBT, and this is very expensive. This costs us many millions of pesos here, or in mean 100,000 of dollars we consume just to design this to become immune to the spike or harmonics. I think that's all. So I hope this helps. Anyway, you must visit if you want to learn more about this. I cannot explain you all the details here for obvious reason. You know, I have investors to protect it, and what I'm showing is just the basic understanding, and just showing you there is a possibility to get power from somewhere, from the ambient. It's not impossible. You can go here sometime. They're discussing my technologies over unity.com, and here EB Gray. EB Gray at yahoo.groups.com, and in Peswaiki, most of the time they give all the details, and this panacea.bokap.com, and sometimes Kalinet. So you can visit their website, and then you can join on EB Gray and as well over unity.com. So that's it. But another thing, if you are good of making this a time division, actually our circuit system have a time division multiplex. We call it TDM. TD. This is what you need. Time division multiplex. And then as well, you must be good knowledge of PWM. It's a pulse wave